Hello, everybody. It's Frosty the Song Man. It is February 15th, 2019, and I've got an exciting video for you tonight. Got lots of props. So, yeah, you're looking at it like, oh, 20 minutes. I can't make it all the way through this. Stick with me. It's going to be a fun journey. All right. It's going to be a fantastic expedition. So this day in 2002, George Michael's London home was broken into, and the thieves stole over 100,000 pounds worth of paintings, jewelry, and designer clothes, and drove off in his Aston Martin DB7 car, and they caused 200,000 pounds worth of damage to his home. I think I have some corn in my teeth. I kind of feel like Nancy Pelosi right now. All right, so this day in 2004, singer Doris Troy died. She had been a session singer on Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon album. So we lost Doris Troy on this day in 2004. And on this day in 1975, Rush releases Fly By Night. This is an excellent album. I love every song on here. So yippee, hooray for that album. All right, so now, this is the album I'm reviewing tonight, Dillard and Clark. And I'm mainly going to focus on Gene Clark tonight. He's probably the main songwriter on the, although, yeah, it looks like Clark wrote a lot of these too. Or Leadon, Dillard wrote a lot, so scratch that. Basically, I'm going to focus on Gene Clark because he was in the Byrds. He put out a lot of albums. He's a major songwriter of the 60s and 70s. So yeah, he's an interesting character. But I'm going to kind of, as a jumping off point, I'm just going to be talking about this album mainly as far as his recordings go. But I'll mention some other recordings of his too. I mean, this is not the only cool thing he's done, but I'll kind of focus on this tonight. And actually, this is two albums. This CD, if you want to get it, it's The Fantastic Expedition of Dillard and Clark and Through the Morning, Through the Night. So I'm actually going to just kind of look at both of these albums because on this CD, they're together. Both of them are cool albums. So even if you get them independently or individually, it's still, you know, that's fine by me. My only complaint is that they look like a couple of San Francisco gays here. But, you know, that's just kind of unfortunate. All right. Dillard and Clark was a duo that was together for only a year between 1968 and 1969. It featured ex-Byrds member Gene Clark. He's this guy here. That's Gene Clark on that side. And that's Doug Dillard. So, Gene Clark was the main songwriter for the Byrds from 1964 to 1966. He was born in Tipton, Missouri. And Missouri is kind of this state, for you guys that aren't Americans, it's this state here. This is the East Coast, Virginia, and then this is Missouri. So, it's kind of in the Midwest area. I don't know if it's technically Midwest, but yeah, it's on the Mississippi River. All right, so Tipton is a tiny town right smack dab in the middle of Missouri, and he was third of 13 children. His family moved to Kansas City, Missouri when he was a boy, and that's where he learned to play guitar and harmonica from his father. He played songs by Hank Williams, Elvis Presley, and the Everly Brothers. Very typical of somebody back in that time. He began writing songs at age 11. In high school, he got interested in folk music and formed a group called the Rum Runners. He was singing in a local folk act called the Surf Riders when he was discovered by the New Christie Minstrels. And they hired him, and he recorded two albums with the New Christie Minstrels. And their New Christie Minstrels is very, they're almost like the Highwaymen, like a really early 60s folk, you know, really happy, cheesy, kind of like, I don't know, I can't think of a I don't know any of their songs, but I checked out some of the music, and it's kind of like, down with my baby, going into town with my baby today, with my baby today. You know, just really happy with a ton of singers, a ton of background singers, really positive music, American folk music. So it's pretty cool stuff. I mean, it's definitely dated, but it's quality stuff. I mean, it's worth checking out, the new Christie Minstrels. So, but he was in that just a short amount of time, and after hearing the Beatles, Gene Clark quit the new Christie Minstrels and moved immediately out to L.A. He was really moved by the Beatles, and yeah, like so many people in that generation, they wanted to form a band like the Beatles after hearing the Beatles. And actually, it's funny because he met somebody out there named Jim McGuinn, who was also a folk artist and was also moved by the Beatles. So he was in a very, very similar musical situation as Gene Clark. And a little story about Jim McGuinn. He's the main singer of the Byrds. He changed his name to Roger McGuinn. And let me tell you this story. It's kind of odd. I mean, Jim was part of a spiritual association in 1965 and was practicing quieting his mind, kind of an Eastern religion type of thing. The leader of the movement told Jim that he would vibrate better with the universe if he changed his name to a name that started with an R. So Jim sent him a list of 10 names, get this, including Rocket, Retro, Ramjet, and Roger. And the leader of the spiritual movement chose Roger, I guess because it was the only name. But I think it would have been cooler if he chose Ramjet, you know, like, hey, Gene, nice to meet you, Ramjet. Jim changed his middle name officially from Joseph to Roger, but he did not officially change his first name, which was James, or, you know, Jim. So he did officially change his middle name to Roger, which was interesting. I didn't know that before researching this. All right, so after Gene Clark met Jim McGuinn at the Troubadour Club in L.A., they decided to form a band and call it the Byrds. So Gene Clark wrote or co-wrote many of the Byrds' best-known originals on their first three albums. This is one of the albums. He wrote or co-wrote, I'll play some of them right now. Feel a Whole Lot Better. The Reason Why. That's a really cool song. He also wrote or co-wrote Here Without You, which is a really eerie kind of ballady type song. Daytime just makes me feel lonely. At night can only dream about you. And another one he wrote was You Won't Have to Cry. You completely butchered those chords. But you kind of get an idea. You might have heard that song before. You won't have to cry. No, you won't have to cry. And then Clark wrote this song, 8 Miles High, after having a conversation with Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones. It was in a Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania hotel room, and they were kind of talking about a lot of crazy, psychedelic, esoteric stuff. And this is the song that came out. I think it was originally titled 6 Miles High, but they changed it to 8 Miles High to sound more like the Beatles 8 days a week, because they were such Beatles fanatics.
8 miles high, and when you touch down, you find that it's stranger than known. Signs in the street that say where you're going are somewhere just being their own.
So kind of very psychedelic type lyrics, almost something John Lennon would write. This song, 8 Miles High, was actually banned from a lot of radio stations because it alluded to sex and drugs. Compared to the stuff they play these days, this is like Pee Wee Herman's, this is like the Sound of Music compared to the sexual stuff I hear on the radio today. It's kind of sad how far off the deep end it's gone. Anyway, Gene Clark was also the writer of Set You Free This Time, If You're Gone, and The World Turns Around Her. Those were all early Byrds records. All right, I'm at 12 minutes. I'm going to keep on keeping on here. All right, so a management decision made by Jim McGuinn, the lead singer of of all the major singles and Bob Dylan songs that the Byrds did. And this disappointment, combined with Clark's fear of flying and general dislike of traveling, led him to quit the Byrds. And he was also under a lot of stress because he was like the main songwriter, so he was earning the most royalties and he was getting rich, and the rest of the people in the Byrds weren't so much, so there was like some jealousy, tension over money there too, which eventually led him to have a nervous breakdown. Gene Clark had a nervous breakdown. And another thing was he was only 19 years old, and just the sudden stardom that hit him was very tough for him. He was kind of a very introverted, melancholy type of guy. So I think just being thrust on the world stage at 19 led to his nervous breakdown. So Columbia Records, which was the Byrds label, signed Clark to a solo artist deal in 1967. And he released his first solo record called Gene Clark with the Gosden Brothers. And Clark briefly rejoined the Byrds in October of 1967 as a replacement for the recently departed David Crosby. He appeared with the Byrds on the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour, which was a really wholesome, funny show back in the 60s. I kind of enjoyed that. Good guys, the Smothers Brothers. He was lip-syncing to the group's current single, Going Back. I think I'm going back to the places that remind me that I used. He also performed Mr. Spaceman with the band. I'm sure you've heard that. Hey, Mr. Spaceman, won't you please... Sorry, I forgot the words, but Clark is generally viewed as having added background vocals to some songs on the notorious Byrd Brothers album, which is this one right here. This is a really cool album. It's got a lot of kind of strange sounds on it, psychedelic stuff, but overall, this is a really good Byrds album. I would definitely recommend getting this one. And he co-authored Get to You, which was another song on this album here. And just a really short, brief thing about the Byrds. There's so many good Byrds albums. I love Sweetheart of the Rodeo. This is a very country rock album. I love it. This is, might have been their first album, I think, but it's got a lot of songs that Gene Clark wrote. I've had this forever. This is a cool live album. This is kind of a later Byrds album, Live at the Fillmore. This was with the Clarence White on guitar. He was kind of a very interesting country style electric guitarist. Easy Rider was kind of later in their history too, the Byrds, but that's a cool album. I mean, all these albums are great. I'd recommend all of these. There's another one that's a live one with Clarence White, the guitarist, that interesting guitarist I was talking about. That's a cool album too. This is a two CD live one. So anyway, I'm a big fan of the Byrds. All right, back to it. So in 1968, Clark signed with A&M Records and began a collaboration with the banjo player Doug Dillard. And now we're getting to the album I'm going to talk about tonight. Also part of the band were Bernie Leadon, who joined the Flying Burrito Brothers and the Eagles. And I love both of those bands, too. Bassist Dave Jackson and mandolin player Don Beck. And Michael Clark briefly joined the band before becoming the drummer for the Flying Burrito Brothers. And Michael Clark, I think, has no relation to Gene Clark. All right, so yeah, Bernie Leadon played on the first Eagles album. All of those solos you hear on "I Get This Feeling I May Know You As a Lover and a Friend." You know that solo, barrel, 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 and or down, down, alright, you guys didn't pay all this money to hear me sing Bernie Leadon solos. But anyway, this is a great album Bernie Leadon played. Yeah, Take It Easy, Witchy Woman, all this stuff. Alright, this video is not about the Eagles. Although, one more thing about the Eagles, this album, Desperado, is probably one of the most undersold albums. It didn't sell that well, comparatively. I mean, it was still the Eagles. It was still a big selling, but compared to other Eagles albums. But I actually really like this. I think this is a fine album, Desperado. All right, so back to this album. And also, very shortly, on the Flying Burrito Brothers, I would totally check out the Flying Burrito Brothers. They're excellent. I love all of their stuff. I think they put out a few albums. Graham Parsons was the singer of that. And yeah, here's some Graham Parsons albums. These are some of his solo albums. Grievous Angel and GP. Both of these are very, very fine albums. And I love a lot of Graham Parsons. Anything he was involved in is really cool. But he died at a young age of drug overdose in a hotel room, I think. He was like in his 20s, so that was a very sad end to his life. He was one of the pioneers of country rock, like Gene Clark was, and like Jim McGuinn of the Byrds was. They were all, I mean, not that that's the only thing they did, but they were, all of those guys were pioneers in, you know, the country rock that was coming around in the 60s and 70s. All right, so they produced two albums, The Fantastic Expedition of Dillard and Clark, which is this one, and Through the Morning, Through the Night. This one was 1968, and this one was 1969. These two were country rock albums, which was a new genre. They were pivotal albums in that genre. One song on the first album was Train Leaves Here This Morning, which also appeared on this first Eagles album. So it's really interesting, if you look on YouTube for Train Leaves Here This Morning Eagles, and then Train Leaves Here This Morning Dillard and Clark, you know, they're very similar, but, you know, obviously a little bit different. So it's kind of interesting. All right, The Fantastic Expedition had some bluegrass on it, and it also had some electric instruments, so it was kind of an eclectic mix of styles. Doug Dillard's girlfriend, Donna Washburn, had joined the band as a backing vocalist, which precipitated the departure of guitarist Bernie Leadon. So I guess that was kind of like a Yoko Ono situation there. These albums did not sell very well, but they are now considered important seminal albums in the genre of country rock. This period saw a spike in Clark's creativity, but his drinking got worse during this period too. In fact, they didn't play many live shows because of Clark's drinking. He was just like hitting the wine all the time. I mean, He was probably hitting the sangria, beer, just getting messed up all the time. So, yeah, he couldn't even play half the time. He was so drunk. And that was getting to be more and more of a problem. Dillard and Clark disintegrated in 1969. Around that time, Clark, Leadon, Jackson, and Beck contributed to the debut album of Steve Young, his debut album called Rock, Salt, and Nails, which is a very, very fine album. I would recommend that one too. Almost every album I'm mentioning tonight, I would totally recommend. It's by Steve Young, and it's called Rock, Salt, and Nails. And it's kind of expensive on some websites, so be ready for that. I guess it's a limited edition type of thing, not a lot of prints out there, maybe. All right, in 1970, Clark began work on new singles with the original members of the Byrds. So he kind of drifted back to the Byrds, got out of the Byrds, went back and made contact with them, went out. So he's kind of like in and out of the Byrds throughout his career. The resulting song, She's the Kind of Girl, and One in 100 were not released at that time for the Byrds or for Gene Clark because of the legal problems it had. But they were later included on the album Roadmaster, which is here. So the songs I just mentioned were on this Gene Clark album. And yet, once again, this is a fine album. There's a better picture of Gene Clark. And not that the homosexual San Francisco biker picture. That's a good picture of him. So anyway, this is a great album too. This is really a lot of kind of ballady stuff, but this is cool too. Cool cover. He's probably drunk there. Sorry, I shouldn't joke about that. So in 1971, Clark contributed vocals and two compositions to albums by the Flying Burrito Brothers, which I've already mentioned. They're a great, great band, worth checking out. Frustrated with the music industry, Clark bought a house on the coast of Northern California and married Carly Lynn Cummings, McCummings. In the summer of 1970. They had two sons, Kelly and Kai. K-A-I, I'm getting drunk myself. And Kelly, K-E-L-L-Y, were their two sons. And Kai actually has his own band in California, following in his dad's footsteps. So yeah, that's worth checking out. Check out Kai Clark. I think they're based in Northern California, and they're doing it now. They're probably gigging, and you can send them an email and say, hey, I listen to your dad's stuff, and I love it. And hopefully you'll say, I listen to your stuff, too, and I love your stuff. All right, so at this time, he had pretty good royalty money coming in from all the songs he had written, Gene Clark had written, including the 1969 American Top 10 hit by the Turtles, You Showed Me. So he was bringing in some great royalty money. All right, we're at 23 minutes. Crap. I'm hurrying, guys. A lot of info here. Clark teamed up with the Byrds yet again, as well as releasing a few more solo albums, including No Other, released in 1974, which some consider his best album. He also recorded an album under the band name McGuinn, Clark, and Hillman in 1979, and that's a very, very fine album, too. In 1985, Clark approached McGuinn, Crosby, and Hillman regarding the reformation of the Byrds, but the three of them showed no interest. However, Clark did get together a group of really great musicians, and they called themselves the 20th Anniversary Tribute to the Byrds and began performing on the lucrative nostalgia circuit in 1985. And their agent eventually just shortened the band name to the Byrds, which understandably angered Jim McGuinn and other Byrds members. They basically kind of just took the Byrds' names without the other Byrds agreeing to it. So that caused a little kerfuffle there. All during this time, Clark's albums were not selling well. So he had to tour to bring in some money to support his wife and two sons. He would take speed and drink alcohol to get through the shows. I'm drinking to get through this video. This did not help his undiagnosed bipolar disorder. So apparently Gene Clark had an undiagnosed bipolar disorder. His wife finally left him moving the kids to Hawaii, knowing Clark would not follow them there due to his fear of flying. I found that interesting. However, in the 1980s, Clark did move to Hawaii, which I guess he flew there. I guess he got over his fear of flying for that one flight. He moved there in an attempt to be with his family and get off drugs, to make a serious attempt to get off drugs. He released an album with a singer named Carla Olson, O-L-S-O-N. The album was released in 1987 and actually saw some commercial success. The following year, Gene Clark is great with duets. When he does duets with people or harmony, his voice just really sounds nice. I would almost argue he's a better singer when it comes to harmony than like a front lead vocalist. You know, like he's not like a Paul McCartney or, you know, like a Robert Plant or somebody like that. He's a little more laid back, and his voice really fits in nicely with other voices adding to his. So I kind of feel the same about my voice sometime, the same way. The following year, Clark had surgery to remove a lot of his stomach and intestines due to the ulcers from drinking all those years. And in 1989, Tom Petty recorded Clark's song Feel a Whole Lot Better on his Full Moon Fever album. So this brought in a lot of royalties, and of course Gene Clark used the money on alcohol, heroin, and crack cocaine. Then in the heat, man, the guy has an addictive personality, I guess. Then in 1991, Clark was diagnosed with throat cancer. All right, on May 24th, 1991, at the age of 46, Clark went on one more bender and died from a bleeding ulcer. He died on his living room floor. He's buried in Tipton, Missouri. And okay, so now a little on Doug Dillard, this guy. Doug grew up on a farm near Salem, Missouri, which is not too far from where Gene Clark was born. He began learning guitar and fiddle at the age of 5 and banjo at the age of 15. His banjo heroes were Earl Scruggs, Ralph Stanley, and Don Reno. I'm sure he was into the Stanley Brothers too. This is a great band for banjo. From 1956 to 1959, Doug was a founding member of the Ozark Mountain Boys with his younger brother. He eventually formed a new band with his brother named the Dillards and a side project named the Folk Swingers. In 1968, Doug Dillard left the Dillards and joined the Byrds for their first European tour. Then he teamed up with Gene Clark to record these two albums, which I talked about. All right, Doug also had a solo career, releasing a few albums and providing the music for the film Bonnie and Clyde. Dillard suffered a collapsed lung and developed a lung infection, and he died in a Nashville hospital in 1991. Which, you know, is weird. I didn't even notice those two guys died the same year. They both died in 1991. I'm just noticing that now. All right, so one of the songs on here, like I mentioned, there's a train leaves here. This morning, it's actually called Train Leaves Here This Morning.
I lost 10 points just for being in the right place at exactly the wrong time. I looked right at the facts there, but I may as well have been completely blind. So if you see me walking all alone, don't look back, I'm just on my way back home. There's a train leaves here this morning, I don't know what I might be on.
A cool song. And then another song off this album is The Fantastic Expedition of Dillard and Clark is a song called Something's Wrong.
Hours of joy when I was just a boy and never wrong. I
That's a cool tune called Something Wrong. Something's Wrong. It's a ballad. All right, so I'll play a few songs off the CD. This one is on the other album on here. And this is called Through the Morning, Through the Night. This is a really sweet song.
Believe me when I tell you I will try to understand. Believe me, tell you never kill a man.
Don't worry, not to worry. Not to worry at all. This is so Bobo. CD skipping. Camera falling down. Rocky Top. You know that tune, Rocky Top. 15. This is
crying,
a gospel song.
To the Lord. Crying,
all right, this is Kansas City Southern. Cool tune. This is called Polly, and this song is actually on this Robert Plant and Alison Krauss album. It's funny, they do two of Gene Clark's songs on this album. They do Polly, they call it Polly Come Home on here, and they also do Through the Morning, Through the Night.
Tell the places you have been.
This is actually one of my favorite songs.